Hey everyone, hi. Preeti and Sohail. We'll just wait for a few minutes so that everybody else will join. So meanwhile, would you mind letting me know where you guys are from? Hey Charan, hi. Hi Dhanush. It's great, great. Hi Ashish, I'm from Hyderabad too. So meanwhile, as we wait for other people to join, I'll just give a quick introduction to myself. I am Sachin from CrunchPrep. I'm a co-founder of CrunchPrep. We've started 5 years ago and we've so far helped thousands of students around the world. We help students study for the GRE. I'm not sure if how many of you have heard of CrunchPrep before this webinar? Hi, Chandu. So we help students take the GRE test, and we have an online test prep platform. You'll be able to take tests and review them. And so we're going to look a little bit more into that as we go forward. But right now, hey, that's nice, Saurav. Yeah. Yes, Charan, I hope you'll be able to learn a little bit about CrunchPrep and what our courses have today. But more importantly, I just wanted to give you guys a quick introduction to the GRE and how it works and why you should take the GRE, when you should take it, and how you should go about your study plans and all of that. How many of you have already started for the GRE prep? You know, is this the first time you're looking into the GRE, or have you already started preparing and taking tests and doing some practice questions here and there? Oh, wow, Uditi, your GRE is in a week, okay. How well prepared are you? Do you feel confident right now? Oh, one more. Saurav also has his GRE on the 8th. Great, great. So shall we start, or shall we wait for the others to join? So I'm hoping all of you guys are looking to start your fall 2020, right? You're applying for the fall season next year. Yeah. Have you already taken the test, Uditi? Great, great. So we're going to start now as we see more and more people coming in. All right. Everybody can see the slide, right? Great. So, oh, that's nice. How did you feel about the CrunchPrep test, Uditi? We're trying to improve every day, but I hope you liked it already. And it's been useful to you, I hope so. So anyway, we'll start the webinar just to understand what the GRE is all about and why it's so important for master's degrees. I hope all of you guys are also applying to the US because it's mostly schools in the US that require the GRE. If anybody here is looking for schools in Germany and Australia and Canada, not every school in those countries require the GRE, but if you're looking for the US, and especially the top schools, getting a really good score on the GRE is really important. Getting a 310, 315 score would get you into one of the top 100 schools in the US. And a lot of my expertise comes from helping students go to schools in the US. So in case I'm not able to help any of you guys with questions regarding schools in Australia and Canada and other countries, I'm sure the team at AdmitCard will be happy to help you. By the way, the chat is going really quickly, so in case I'm not able to help answer any of your questions, you can see my email address at the top of the chat. You can send me an email anytime, and I'll be happy to respond. Okay, so let's start. If you understand, because some of you guys haven't started and they're just starting out your prep, I just want to give you a quick overview of what we're going to do today. Mostly it's going to be what the GRE is about, and it's a big picture view of how you're going to prepare and what the test looks like and what are the different question types. Maybe people like Uditi and other people who have already taken the test and have their GRE in the next 1 week may find it a little bit repetitive, but in the hopes that it will help the larger audience here, I hope we'll just quickly cover the format and the pattern. And also, I hope those strategies that we're going to discuss will be helpful universally for all of you guys. And we're also going to look at why it's important for learning the GRE vocabulary, because some of you guys here who are hoping to improve on the verbal section, getting a good score on the verbal 150 plus requires a really good understanding of advanced vocabulary. And by the way, so what I have noticed from CrunchPrep students and the feedback that they have given us over the past few months is that the verbal section is getting a little bit trickier, especially in terms of the text completion questions. And we'll anyway be looking at these question types. And then I'll be giving you a little bit more detail into each of these question types. And at the end, we'll also see some study and practice resources. So just to help you guys, because there's not a lot of helpful material out there apart from the official ETS guides, which are great, by the way. So we'll be looking at those as well. So in the meantime, if you have any questions, please feel free to leave the message there. All right, so firstly, to start off with the test format, the GRE, as you all might have already known, it's around a three and a half hour test. It starts off with an analytical writing assessment section where you have two different essay questions. Each essay question is for 30 minutes and it goes on for 60 minutes. And I understand a lot of students, especially from India, have a lot of problem getting a score higher than 4.0 on the analytical writing. But in fact, it's actually very easy to score a 5 or more on the GRE if you just pay attention to a few tips and strategies that you just need to take care of. So one quick tip for me right now is that you can prepare a few templates, so to speak, just to write, include a really good vocabulary in your sentences. And while this is really tough to write on the real exam, because you just have 30 minutes to not only just think about your ideas, but also write a good essay, it's important that you understand some of the good vocabulary that you would want to use within the writing section. And after the two essays are done, you go to the quant section where you have two different quant sections and then two different verbal reasoning. So I hope you already know that these are alternate sections. So if you get a quant section on the first try, in the first section, you'll get the verbal next, and then again a quant, again a verbal. And then there'll be an experimental section as well, which is what we'll go a little bit deeper into as we move forward. So let's look at each of these sections and see what they're about. So first, as I said, the first section is common for every one of you guys. No matter where you take the test, when you take the test, the first section will always be analytical writing. And you have two essays essentially in this 60-minute period. You have 30 plus 30, which is one is first essay will be an argument essay, and then there'll be an issue essay. In the argument essay, what you'll actually find is there'll be an argument question. There'll be a question stem that is put forward as an argument. And most of the time, like 95 to 99% of the time, this argument contains a lot of issues, right? I mean, any sensible person, if they read that argument, they'll understand there's a lot of loopholes and, you know, mistakes or drawbacks with the argument. And you can basically, so your prompt would ask you to write your response to that argument. So somebody might say, I'm not getting a good score on the GRE, so I won't go to the US at all. So that's a bad argument, right? The good argument is, why don't you study for the GRE? Where are you lagging behind? So these are the different questions that you might ask someone, right? In a similar way, an argument will give you a very vague, usually faulty argument and which you can attack. And the issue essay is more of a very generalized philosophical or political, you know, issue statements, just a single line statement. Just for an instance, you know, a statement might ask you, politicians should follow what their voters tell them and not do the right thing. So whether you agree with it or not, it doesn't matter. It's the same for both argument and issue essay. Nobody cares about your political viewpoints or the way you put forward your arguments. All they care about is how well you're writing, the construction of your passages, I mean, the essay, and how good your sentence structures and the vocabulary are. Nobody cares about your personal political points of view. So you don't have to think too much or worry about whether the reader or the grader is going to look at my essay badly if I write something that is against the norm. So, and because you only have 30 minutes per essay, I would certainly recommend making a few templates before you actually go for the test. You know, analytical writing, to be very honest, shouldn't take more than 2-3 days to prepare. Maybe, hardly speaking, it shouldn't take more than 6 to 8 hours to prepare. You just have to understand what ETS actually, by the way, has a really good portal on their website giving you the list of all the questions, all the argument and the issue essay questions that you might get on the test. So there won't be any out of syllabus questions in the essay section. There are around 150 argument essays and 150 plus issue essays on the GRE website, ETS website. And if you just go or casually look at some of those essay questions and practice at home, one of those questions will come on the exam. So it's not something that you should really worry about. I would recommend that you worry more about the verbal and the quant sections. So just briefly, the scores for analytical writing is between 0 and 6, and usually it's in 0.5 increments because your argument essay and issue essay are scored separately and then averaged, and your final AWS score would be the average of these two essays. So anybody who gets a 4.0 or more is considered excellent. A 5.0 or more is brilliant. So it shouldn't take more than 2 to 3 days to get a 4.0 or more. So which brings me to the next subject, which is quantitative reasoning. Now, it's not obvious that the quant section will be your first section after the AWS section. It could be verbal also, but then, so if it's a quant in the first section, the second would be verbal. So it's always going to be alternate. So for the sake of, time, I would say Q1 and Q2 and V1 and V2 so that it's easier for us to understand. So Q1 is the quantitative section 1 and Q2 is the quantitative section 2 and so on. So you get two sections on the GRE, so Q1 and Q2. And then once Q1 is done, you will get a V1, which is verbal section 1, and then Q2 and then V2. Now, the small difference here is that the quant section requires you to answer 20 questions and it gives you 35 minutes for the section. But the verbal section, on the other hand, will have 30 minutes only, and then still gives you 20 questions to answer. And within the verbal section, you'll see text completion, sentence equivalence, and reading comprehension. We'll just quickly look at these question types as well. But this is basically it. So you get 20 questions per section, which means 40 on the verbal and 40 on the quant. And that is exactly why you have the GRE scores between 130 and 170. So if you get all the 40 questions in verbal right, you get a 170 on the verbal section. So each question is 1 point. Every question is treated equally by the GRE. So, and I would really suggest that is the reason. Do not get hung up on solving one particular question. If that question seems really hard, do not get hung up on it. This is one of the biggest mistakes a lot of students make. They try to get that solution, you know, trying to prove themselves that, you know, I'm smart enough to solve this. But the real smartness comes in solving as many questions as can in the 30-minute period, not every single question, because unless you're targeting 170 on the math and the verbal sections, getting a 340 score, which is highly impossible for most people, you should really look at solving as many questions as you can in that 30-minute period. So because you can mark and skip these questions and move around within the section without any problem, you have to mark it and then move on if you are unable to answer any question within 30 seconds to 1 minute. So that's one of the tips that most students don't remember. So next time people here who are looking to improve their scores, it's really helpful for you to mark questions and then move on. And then maybe if you have time in the end, you can come back and solve them. Or if not, then that's fine too. Because even if you skip 5 questions and answer 15 in each section correct, you will still be getting a 320 score on the GRE. So which is really a super high score, excellent score for most top schools in anywhere in the world. So do not get hung up on one or two very complicated or hard questions. Because each question is considered same, every question carries 1 point, no matter how hard it is. Whether it is a simple question or a hard reading comprehension question, it's still 1 point per question. So always keep this in mind, guys. So like I said, you get 2 quant and 2 verbal, and there'll be an experimental section. The funny thing about this is it's really hard to explain in a 30 minute or a 60 minute webinar. But what I would like to say is do not get hung up on it. A lot of students make the mistake of understanding which of my sections is really the experimental section. You know, you don't have to try and become a Sherlock Holmes to understand, because the GRE will never let you know whether the section that you're writing right now is a real section or an experimental section. So it's better to not care about all of those things, so trying to decode the exam and just simply answer those questions. Sometimes you get, so if I, like I said, for example, if you get a Q1, V1, Q2, V2, it doesn't mean you have to get a experimental section in quant, you would get a verbal also. So nobody knows. So the best thing to do here is just chill out and then take the section, give every section the same amount of attention and care that you would give to other sections also. But the thing about experimental is that it's just for the GRE to test some new questions before they launch it for the future batches. I mean, some students might say it's really unfair, but that's the part of the test. So the only bad thing here is that the entire section goes unscored. But because you don't know which of your 5 sections are going to be unscored, you should take all 5 sections with equal care and equal tenacity instead of trying to figure out which one of them is experimental, so you can skip some time. Do not do that at all. So the syllabus is pretty very, very simple. It's not a complicated exam at all, because if you look at the official guide and the official websites of the ETS, these are the topics that you'll be tested on. Basic, for Indians, it's pretty easy when it comes to quantitative reasoning, because all of the things that they'll test you on are 10th standard mathematics in algebra and arithmetic and geometry. And in data analysis, you'll have statistics and all of those other small topics that anybody can solve. But the thing about the GRE is that it often combines 2 different topics. For example, it might give you a circle with a radius that is also like a root of a quadratic equation, something like that. It often combines 2 or 3 concepts in one single question, so which is why it's really difficult for a lot of students. But as long as you're really good at the basics, none of these topics are really hard to understand. So do not, unless you're really bad at math or you haven't taken a math course in several years, I would suggest not spending a lot of time on these math topics. But I would rather suggest you to spend whatever time you have to actually practice the questions. So you will see the combination of these topics and how you'll be able to answer each of them on the real day. Similarly, for verbal reasoning, it's just two skills that you're looking at. One is reading comprehension, and the second one is, do you know any advanced vocabulary? Now, all of these skills are really useful for anybody who's trying to get into any STEM program in the master's degree, which is why the GRE tests these skills. So do not be cynical about, you know, why would I need advanced vocabulary? Because if you're going into STEM field, obviously, you will be reading a lot of scientific papers written by experts. Even if you're going into a literature program or a psychology program or any political program, all of these would have a dense and long papers and case studies that you would be reading. So knowledge of vocabulary and the ability to comprehend data, not just reading it, but reading it and then understanding it instantly is really important. And these are skills that you'll only get through by practice. Even with respect to the quantitative reasoning I just told you about, the combination of topics and subtopics within a question type can only be answered well if you are good at practicing them. So there's no pointing in understanding every single formula there is for circles or for triangles. The point is, are you able to use those skills or those formula or those shortcuts on the real test? So actually taking practice tests, taking quizzes, solving really tough questions is what will get you a really good score, not going through the theory and the concepts. So we'll just quickly look at what are the question types that are there on the GRE. So in the math section, you'll have four different question types. One, for the first is the quantitative comparison. This is really a unique question type of all the tests that you probably have taken since you were in high school. So you basically, as you can see here, you'd be given. So this is just a random question I've given. So do not try to solve it. We're not looking to solve these questions right now because of the paucity of time. We don't have that much time to actually go through in detail and solve these questions. I just wanted to give you a quick overview of how the question types look like. So in the quantitative comparison question, you have a question stem. So here, as you can see, it talks about the probability experiment. And then it gives you two quantities, A and B. And literally, it's just what the question type says, quantitative comparison. So a lot of students, what they make the mistake here is that they try to solve the question. And for example, the quantitative A says the probability that G and H will occur. So they try to actually go deep into it, use formulas and solve. But instead, what you should be doing is actually trying to compare A and B and use logic and deduction from the concepts that you know to understand which one of them is greater. That's it. Now, each of these question types would require like a lot more time to get into the detailed strategies and things like that. And we'll be probably doing that in a future webinar for each of these question types. But for now, I'm just going to give you an overview of each of the question types. The second is, obviously, you might have known this. Anybody who's taken any online test would know how this works. It's a multiple choice, which has one correct answer only. So it will give you five options. You have to choose one. And the next one is a slightly more complicated. You get options. So you might get anywhere between 3 to 9 options, answer choices here. And sometimes just one of them might be correct. Sometimes all of them might be correct. Sometimes only a few of them might be correct. So you have to really get down to the answer in order to get this question type correct. There is no partial credit for getting just one of the answer choices correct. So I would really recommend, unless you're looking for a really high score, to skip this entire question on the real test, unless you've completed all the other question types. So you can come back to this at the end of the section if you have time. So focus your energies on the single answers and the quantitative comparison because they're much easier and they give you a better bang for the buck, so to speak, because you're spending the same amount of time, but you just have to select one answer there, where here you might need to find out three or four of them to be the right answers. And most of the time you might be wrong. So it's better to skip it until the end of the quant section and then come back if you can solve it. So the next one, the final one, is the numerical entry. It's a simple thing. Instead of a single answer question type, there's simply a blank and then you have to type in the answer choice. So this is a very easy thing. And you anyway on the GRE, by the way, I forgot to tell you that you have a calculator. So for question types like this, you don't have to worry too much. You just have to use the calculator and get the answer inside. So there's a These are the so numerical entry questions are probably the easiest of all. So do not try to mess with these questions. These are like free money for you guys. You know, you can just get free points on the quant section because numerical entry are usually very easy also. So going to next, so you have 3 to 4 data interpretation questions. You know, data interpretation, it's like any other standardized test out there. So you get a graph, sometimes there is 2, sometimes there is 3 graphs. It depends on the difficulty level of the question. And then you get 3 to 4 questions based off of the graph. So data interpretation, by the way, also easy, pretty easy. Next to numerical entry, data interpretation are very easy to get a good score because all you have to do is spend 2 minutes, two quality minutes on understanding the data there and the graphs there. And all the 3 and 4 questions can be answered in one go without any issues. You don't have to read the question every time. Yes, Suditi, the calculator accepts inputs from the keyboard, yes. And there's also a transfer display button. So once you do a complicated calculation and you get an answer there, you can save time by just clicking the transfer display and the answer on that calculator will automatically be transferred into this the text box on the numerical entry question type. So next, moving on to the verbal section, this is, I understand that for a lot of Indian students and a lot of non-native speakers, the verbal section is really, really tough, but then that is totally fine because you don't have to, give me a second. So because you don't have to, unlike the math section, you don't have to target a 165 or a 170 on the verbal section. I'm hoping all of you guys are targeting the 310, 320 mark on the GRE, which is easy to achieve in 2 to 3 months. And for that, even if you can get a 165 on the math, you can get done with 155 on the verbal section. So don't worry too much about it. It's not about how many words you know and how much of the vocabulary that you're a master of. It's about whether you're able to use it. Again, I'm repeating myself here by telling you that it's not what you know, but whether you can actually use that knowledge on the test, whether it is with respect to math formulae or the verbal section vocabulary, whether you're able to use that vocabulary in context. So if you look at the question type here, so there's a sentence and there are 6 different words. So you have to be really able to understand if you can actually use these words within the sentence and it still makes sense, right? So understanding the vocabulary is really important, not just knowing those words. So, and oftentimes it's important to remember that English words have 5 to 6 different meanings for the same word when used in a different context. So you have to be really careful about that as well. So for specific to the sentence equivalence, you always will have just a single blank and then you'll have 6 answer choices and 2 of them are right. So there's no partial credit again, like the multiple choice for just getting one of the words right. You have to get both the words right. So it could be any one of these 6. Any 2 of these 6, but the good thing here is that both of those would be either actual synonyms or very near synonyms. So for example, if you look at this question type, if you just look at the answer choices, persistence and ambition look very similar to each other, right? The others don't make sense. Talent and genius also might be near synonyms. So you can pick out the 2 synonym pairs. And then by understanding the context of the given sentence, you can choose which 2 could be the answer choices. So it's not a very complicated question type, but as long as you understand the vocabulary in context, you'll be able to get a really good score on the sentence equivalence. The next is the text completion. This is slightly the more complicated. To me, it's like the most complicated question type on the GRE because you have 3 different question types within text completion, the single blank and the double blank and the triple blank. Single blank is the easiest because it's similar to sentence equivalence, wherein you have just 1 blank and 5 different choices, and one of them is right. So it's pretty straightforward, just like the single answer choices in math. But if you go to the double blank, you have 2 different blanks, and both the blanks should fit here and make sense. So, and sometimes it's really hard to get these questions right because there's often no context. Unless you get one of the blanks right. So if you look at this question, for example, unless you get the first blank, you wouldn't be able to understand the second blank the context for the second blank. So you should be really careful with the text completion double blank. And the triple blank is even slightly more complicated than this, as you'll see just now. So, and again, just like with the multiple choice, I would really recommend you guys to skip the triple blank questions entirely until the end of the test. If you have time, you're in luck, you can do it later. If you don't have time, then it's totally fine. It's totally fine to skip, because if you can see questions like this, this is kind of like a mini reading comprehension passage. So you might need 3 to 4 minutes just to understand the whole context and try out different permutations and combinations with the blanks here. So this will take a really long time for you guys to get it right. And like I said, every single question on the GRE carries 1 point. So whether you get this really lengthy question correct or just a sentence equivalence or a single blank text completion right, you still get the same points, right? So why don't you use your time and energy on the simpler questions than a complicated question like this? You should try to do this, but at the last, you know, once you're done with everything, once you have like 5-6 minutes of time left, you can do this, because triple blank questions will be one or two of them per section. So if you don't have time, it's completely fine to skip them, because if you can get the remaining 18 questions correct, then you're already in the top percentiles. And so there's a reading comprehension. This is pretty straightforward. I don't think anybody has any issues with that. A lot of students from India and other non-native speaking countries have a lot of issues with reading comprehension, because honestly speaking, if you're from an engineering background or any STEM fields, it's not STEM undergrads, we're not used to, honestly speaking, reading a lot of material. You know, we are used to doing a lot of equations and solving questions and things like that, but reading dense material is not something that we often do in college, unless you're in a field like that in the humanities and the social sciences. So I would really recommend you guys to do a lot of reading, no matter where you read it. It's anything that is in English, start reading today, whether it is an op-ed from a local newspaper, or it's a blog post on Medium, or it's a online newspaper like New York Times and things like that. Wherever you can get a lot of detailed and lengthy content, you should read that. Make it a habit to read, because on the GRE you have, as you've already seen, just 30 minutes for 20 questions, right? But the reading comprehension could be a double-edged sword in the sense that it's really difficult to understand these passages and retain information. But if you're able to do that, you can answer 3 to 4 questions based off of that. It's just like the data interpretation graph, right? You just understand the passage once and you're done. You can simply go ahead answering all the questions without going back to the passage. So it's kind of like a double-edged sword. So unless you're really good at reading complicated, lengthy passages, you wouldn't be able to get a lot of these questions right. So I would really recommend doing that as well. Just reading a lot of good quality English newspapers, preferably from US and UK publishers, like The Guardian and New York Times, you know, every single day, just read, you know, casually, because a lot of students have complained to me that over the years that they find it boring, and they might, you know, feel like sleeping during the passage. So it's really important that you get used to reading lengthy material. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense, because most of these passages are very honest. It's boring to even me. You know, even I don't like learning about, phytoplanktons and all of that, things that I'll never learn about. But if you make it a point to read and find happiness in reading and learning and new information, you can actually get a really good score on the reading comprehension section. So now that we've just seen all the question types, I've tried to give you a few pointers for each of the question type briefly, but here is the overall strategy that you should do. No matter when your test is, it doesn't matter if your test is next week or in 6 months, this is exactly the strategy that you should be looking for. These are the 10 different points. So the first point I would say is, if you've already not taken a test, to take a practice test, preferably on the PowerPrep one, you know, the ETS official PowerPrep practice test, because that is slightly, it's not exactly close to the real GRE. The real GRE is much tougher than the PowerPrep, but it's the closest that you have on the entire internet. You can't find a better test than the PowerPrep. Even CrunchPrep's tests even though I am from CrunchPrep, I'm still telling you that PowerPrep is the closest to the real GRE. So it's better to take that test. So you'll get an idea of, okay, if today is my GRE, how much am I going to score? So that is really important to understand, because a lot of students just start off practicing for the GRE without understanding what their weak areas are, what score they are going to get. So you probably already, every one of you guys has a target score in mind, but you don't know how close you are to that target score, right? So it's important to take the test and understand which your weak areas are. If your weak area is in verbal, within verbal, is it text completion? Is it sentence equivalence and things like that? And then once you get to understand how close you are to the real target score of yours, you can create your own study plan. So you already know, okay, I have to learn algebra. So I have to practice a lot of algebra questions. And how long I think I can take? I think it might take 20 hours for me to get a good score on the quant section. So I have work, I have college or something like that. So you can get into a really good study plan on your own. Never follow study plans that are there on the internet, because they don't know you and your schedule. So you can create your own study plan based off of your own schedule. So do a lot of practice. And I would really recommend taking a mock test every single week. This is really important, because a lot of students don't do that. They just take one test in the beginning and probably one test maybe a couple of days before the real GRE. And it's not going to help you guys, because you have to keep track of whether you're improving or not. And if you have to do that, you have to take a mock test every single week. Try to get a lot of mock tests on the internet. You can buy some of them. Yeah, for instance, CrunchPrep offers some of them. You can even buy mock tests from ETS official website, although each of those tests is $40. So it's kind of expensive, but still they're really, really amazing resource for you to practice. And finally, you have to read whether it is vocabulary or a lot of passage material, like I already said, newspapers, op-eds, reports and things like that. You have to learn, because you can kill two birds with one stone. You'll get used to reading a lot of passages, and oftentimes these newspapers contain really amazing vocabulary that you probably never had heard of in the past. So it'll help you understand the vocabulary also. Just keep track of any new words that you come across, read them on the dictionary, and try to create your own sentences. That's the most important thing, because as I already said, it's not easy for you to remember a word if you don't know how to use it within a sentence or within a particular context. So if you come across a new word, try to form your own sentence and then write it down, and you'll definitely remember it. And finally, the GRE, more than anything else, is a really good test of your time management. Like I already said in the beginning, a lot of students get hung up on one or two questions and then waste their entire time. You just have 30-35 minutes per section, guys. So it's important to be a good time manager there, to understand, okay, to just give up sometimes, you know, okay, I'm not good at this question, let me just leave it be. I'll just mark it and then move on. So that moving on is the most important part of the GRE, not trying to get every single question correct, because that could be very costly mistake for you at the end, because you might find yourself having 2 minutes left and six questions to solve. A lot of our students have faced this, and that's really important, because you cannot pause the test or anything on the real GRE. It's important that you master time and understand. If you're unable to, this is just a quick tip. If you're unable to understand how to solve a problem within 30 seconds, just skip it. Come back to it at the end. So if you do these things, I'm pretty sure you guys can crack a 310 plus score for sure, because we have seen thousands of students who've gotten 310 without much preparation, because the GRE doesn't require a lot of preparation in the sense of the concepts, because everybody knows these concepts, and most of the vocabulary is also not super difficult unless you're targeting the 165 plus on verbal section. But all it requires is dedicated, simple, straightforward study plan and a dedicated practice regime. Just try to get up 1-3 hours of practice every day depending on your free time, and you will easily be able to crack 310 in 3 to 4 weeks. It shouldn't take longer than that. If it's taking longer than that, then you should be worried, because it shouldn't take longer than that. And in that case, you can reach out to any one of us or sign up for any course online to understand where you're going wrong, or go and talk to one of your friends or seniors who have probably gotten a good score on the GRE, because oftentimes it's more the strategy than the concept, because everybody knows the concept, but we all have different strategies. So if you can fix that strategy, you can get a really good score. So these are the resources that I would really recommend you guys to follow. Obviously, it's the official guides and the Power Prep tests in the beginning, because even though a lot of you might have these books of official guides, I would recommend getting the PDFs, because the GRE is a computer-based test. So get used to looking at the computer screen and solving questions like that instead of trying to solve questions on the book, because it's not natural when it comes to the real test. So get used to those test conditions. And Power Prep tests obviously are a really amazing resource to get good practice. And so CrunchPrep we have a wonderful blog there. So hundreds and thousands of students have gone through our guides and blogs. So it's all available for free. Just go to crunchprep.com and go to our blog. You'll find tons of free content and guides and suggestions and strategies for you to improve your score in every single topic that we discussed so far. We also have flashcards, and I would really recommend getting flashcards. If not CrunchPrep, any other flashcards are also fine, because it's important for you to remember these words in context. So flashcards really help you improve words in context and not just the words themselves. And finally, so we have the GRE course, and we are actually offering a specific and offer for you guys because of our friends at AdmitCard. So our CrunchPrep courses have all these features. As you can see, you can get to watch a lot of video lessons for each of the concepts. Although I said, it's not important for you to get down to the details, this is really helpful if you have 4 or 5 months for the GRE. You can really get to the 325, 330 level scores if you can get to all of our video lessons. So where we break down each question type and each question and get into the strategy of solving every question. And we have mock tests. Like I said, you should take a mock test every single week. So if you can take a mock test, try to get the ETS Power Prep test in the beginning. But obviously, there are only 2 free tests. So if you run out of them, you can definitely make use of our CrunchPrep practices. Ours is very close to the real GRE. I'm not saying this because I'm from here. It's actually the reports that our students have given us, and we try to keep improving our tests and the algorithm based on what our students tell us. And we have tons of practice questions, over 2,000 of them, so you can practice them at leisure. And there's also tracking for you to keep track of whether you're improving or not improving at all. So in case you have any questions, if you're not improving, we're there to help. So I'll not just move on to questions. So if any one of you guys quickly have any specific questions that you would want me to answer, I'll be happy to do it. We have a few more minutes left. But if you really want to get into the preparation strategy and discuss more about how you can get a 310 or 320 score on the GRE, you can feel free to shoot me an email at sachin@crunchprep.com, as you can see at the top of the chat, and I'll be happy to help. Any questions, guys? So, all right, guys, so thank you for joining me on the chat today. As I said, feel free to email me if you have any questions. I'll be happy to help. So, see you, and good luck with the GRE.